ready to leave the elevator number 4.
Roger, en sortant de l'église de Saint-Lambert, la situation pour la côte Sainte-Catherine, la route 52, Dallier 5, in ballast. Destination Covered Bay, the lake is pilot required, then over. Pour la voie maritime, les tirants d'eau avant 42,6, arrière 52,5, en l'est,
Often, men seek one thing, find another. Looking for China, Jacques Cartier stumbled on America. By such trial and error, maps now can reveal the vast landmass of the New World. On them, we can repeat journeys first made by paddle and sail, follow the course of the St. Lawrence River and the Great Lakes, mount the watery stairway that leads into the very heart of North America.
More than 400 years after Cartier, Calypso too will retrace the path of the explorers who opened the continent, now vastly changed. Cartier found a new and untouched land. The Cousteau team will explore the same land after four centuries of expanding human occupation. Near the river's mouth, the voyagers find a world seemingly little altered. A shimmering seascape of water and green wilderness, still lost in the hush of time. Here, flights of seabirds are guided by the maps of memory and ancient instinct. Here, the great whales sometimes follow the salt tide hundreds of miles upstream. Here, a wide array of creatures of land and sea and air pursue their lives in ever-changing balance. Yet, under the Calypso helicopter, the designs of man soon appear. The river and its tributary streams, the surrounding forest and tundra, are marked by the evidences of his enterprise and technical virtuosity. Ingeniously, man has learned to make one resource work for another. Let the river's flow transport the immense weight of logs brought down from the hinterland. Here the flow has been channeled into an 11-mile flume. On it rides an endless chain of logs to holding ponds for a paper mill, producing 450,000 tons of newsprint each year. Deep in the backcountry, stored in huge reservoirs by barriers such as the Manicouagan Dam, the water is released to create electrical energy. Distributed over a vast grid serving both Canada and the United States, the electricity powers factories and lights concert halls in cities hundreds of miles away. Yet in the shadow of these monumental works of modern man, a more ancient settler still endures. Descendants of the first Americans who crossed from Asia when the ice was still 2 miles deep over half the American continent. The Indians still catch fish much as they did 10,000 years ago. Once the voyageurs came in birch bark canoes, now they come in Zodiacs. Briefly truant from the main river, the arrival of the Calypso team creates an excited stir in the Mingan Indian camp. Led by Bernard Delamotte and Raymond Cole, the team finds a warm welcome. From one of the tribal leaders, the team learns that the villagers have made camp to net the salmon now struggling through the great rapids to spawn upstream. With ancient hospitality, the visitors are invited to remain for a feast of salmon. As the fire is prepared and the company begins to gather, the Indians easily exchange stories in the backwoods French inherited from the earliest Europeans to settle in Quebec. Like a figure from myth, Cousteau descends from the sky in the Calypso helicopter to become the honored guest of the Mingan chief. In the dusk, the past lies deep. For a little while, host and visitor share an interval in which time is measured not by the clock, but by the seasons. They talk of the tribal hunting journeys, of the spawning runs, of the complex harmonies of nature in which the Indian has lived not as lord, but as partner. Now dwarfed by dams, often exile in his familiar homeland, his fishing rights challenged by rich sportsmen's clubs, he looks on the blessings of the modern world sometimes with bitterness, often with ironic humor. The chief tells Cousteau of a sports club owner who insists that the river is his private property. He comes from the USA, says the chief. So I tell him, if he owns the river, let him take it back to the United States. Now in the main flow of the great river, Calypso encounters increasing numbers of the freighters and other vessels that make the St. Lawrence one of the most heavily traveled passages in the world. Along it, more than 10,000 ships, totaling as much as 100 million tons, pass each year during the 8 ice-free months. Along the riverbanks lie the mute hulls of smaller vessels, wrecked or outmoded by modern carriers. Yet the men of the great ships know that despite every modern device, they too are vulnerable to ice and storm. Perhaps most treacherous of all is the sudden descent of fog. A great white wall of chill vapor or low-lying patches that make of the river's passage a hazardous game of blind man's buff. Because of fog on the lower river near Rimouski, the luxury liner Empress of Ireland became one of the greatest marine disasters of peacetime. At 2 a.m. on the morning of May 28, 1914, she was struck amidships by a Norwegian collier and sank in 14 minutes with a loss of more than 1,000 lives. With a side-scan sonar, Calypso makes the search for the Empress lying barely 4 miles from shore in 150 feet of water. In the instrument room behind the bridge, the crew keeps patient vigil. Less patient is 87-year-old Ronald Ferguson, telegraph operator on the doomed vessel and one of the few living survivors. Escorted by expedition leader Jean-Michel Cousteau, Ferguson reaches the instrument room just as the sonar receiver begins to trace a familiar outline lying on the river bottom.
Here she comes.
The Empress has been found again.
This is a cross-section, of course, as we go over. It's probably one of the narrow parts of the ship.
That's a wonderful picture you've got.
Like hidden tombs of ancient royalty, the Empress is well protected by the murky water and currents that sweep across the hull. A little world lies buried here with most of those who so briefly inhabited it. In darkness lie the pretensions of luxury, the ornate furnishings, the palm court, the stained glass skylights. Glimpsed in the divers' lights, skeletal apparitions mock the faded album photos of a grand stairway and ballroom. The floor where dancers whirled is now occupied by less antic creatures. The marine organisms and barnacles, which prefer to pass their lives firmly anchored to a single place. Dining room where passengers once feasted on marine delicacies is now occupied by other guests who seldom pay a check. Led by Philippe Baudry, an enthusiast who has made earlier descents to the sunken ship, the divers at last find a few odds and ends left behind in the captain's cabin. First, an inkwell. than a straight razor of the kind commonly used in the earlier part of the century. At last, a round piece of glass, the long-lost cover of the captain's clock, which Beaudry salvaged years ago and now remains in the Rimouski Museum of the Wreck. Slowly, bearing their slim list of retrieved treasures, the divers begin the long ascent to the surface, where Jean-Michel and Ferguson await them.
These are the bubbles
from the
divers.
Yes, I see.
Which is a very nice way to know where they are. If you see the bubbles over there, you know they are maybe midship or another location.
I see. Yes. And you know they're breathing, of course.
And you know they're breathing. Yes. You had a little adventure when you got on the ship after your rescue.
Oh, yes. Well, I managed to get into a boat. I caught the boat as it was crossing me. I swam into it. And I thought it was the swell that helped me to put my leg over the side. But thinking it over, I'm sure somebody gave me a pulling hand.
And then you passed out.
And no, I then began pulling people in.
I see.
Sitting and pulling people in. We pulled so many in that a lot of oars and things that were in the boat got across my knees, I remember. And that's the last thing I remember. I passed out, and I came to being rubbed down very vigorously, naked, of course. They'd taken off my pajamas, my civilian overcoat, my uniform jacket, and my civilian overcoat that I had put on while I was dealing with the wireless stuff on board and while before she sank.
So you did well.
Yeah.
And then you transferred on the other ship.
Yes, I was going to say I jumped onto the Lady Evelyn when she came alongside because they were calling for a Marconi man, you see.
I see.
And people gave me a push from behind and other people caught me down there. And then I started work.
Then you started working, calling
to Father Point.
Survivors and the parents, survivors, the families.
Oh, no, because it wasn't... telephone, it was purely Morse operation.
Yeah, I understand that.
And I got the people to write telegrams. They had to find paper and they had to find pencils because there was nothing in the wireless room. It hadn't come into commission yet.
And what paper did you use?
Yes, they found a roll of lavatory paper.
First to appear from the river is Beaudry, delighted with his finds.
Morning.
Good morning.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Have you enjoyed yourself?
Sure. This is an inkwell.
Okay.
And this is the cover of the clock, captain's clock, that we found
the clock
a year
you
before.
Got there.
Yes.
You found the clock, but you didn't find the cover.
We didn't find the cover at the time.
So now, the cover had fallen down, maybe.
Yes. So we just found it. And here we are.
That's a coincidence.
You remember Bernard?
There he is.
You can recognize me.
Good morning to you.
Nice to see you.
Have you enjoyed your trip?
Oh, yeah, good.
Yes,
that's a good boat, huh?
Yes.
That was yours?
What?
That was your boat?
It was, yes.
It's still there.
Yeah, still there. Thank you for telling me. So I'm standing above it now.
We look for a... for your radio room,
and it's finished.
It was completely destroyed there.
Yes. Well, it was
nearly seven decades after the captain's clock was stopped. One of the Calypso crew cleans and polishes the glass cover still stained by its long submersion. Souvenir of a little remembered tragedy, it is a trivial object. Yet through such slight mementos, men can sometimes for an instant touch the past. Hold history in their hand. Always the river leads westward, upstream from the thinly settled coastal territories. Near Tadoussac, where the Saguenay empties its chill current into the St. Lawrence, Calypso crosses a line of foam, that marks the farthest inland reach of the saltwater tides, more than 500 miles from the open sea. At last, from the Calypso, Cousteau sights the great citadel of Quebec City, one of the earliest French strongholds in North America. Yet here, as elsewhere, it was not only distance men had to conquer, nor a harsh climate, nor the unfamiliar ways of a new land. It was each other. Here, for nearly three centuries, French and English, colonist and Indian, clashed for control of the new continent. Here today, the struggle continues for the rights of ancient identities. It still is easier to build bridges across rivers than between men. Farther upstream, Calypso approaches the tall towers of Montreal, commercial and cultural center of French Canada. Today, a glittering cosmopolitan city of 3 million, port for the ships of 60 nations, Montreal first came into existence as a transfer point for goods moving between the Western settlements and Europe. The reason lay here in the nearby rapids, which blocked larger vessels and effectively cut water communications between the St. Lawrence and the Great Lakes. Frustrated in his search for the Northwest Passage to the Orient, Jacques Cartier ruefully named the rapids La Chine, for he was certain that China lay not far beyond. Today, the rapids are irrelevant. Around them and other obstacles, Canada and the United States have built a great international seaway. Dwarfed by the huge chambers, Calypso enters the first of the series of 16 locks, the canals and bypasses by which she will mount step by step from the St. Lawrence to Lake Superior, most distant of the inland seas, more than 600 feet above the river. With a rush, the water pours into the lock, causing a sudden turbulence in the constricted space, often straining the hawsers of larger ships with less than 2 feet to spare on either side of the hull. For the average Laker, no less than 20 million gallons of water are required to lift it to the next level. As the gates at last open and Calypso is released, she passes other waiting ships, part of the great fleet of seagoing vessels that carry iron ore, coal, or wheat, anywhere along an inland water corridor 2,300 miles long. Sometimes it is man himself who creates the obstacle. At Moses Dam in Ontario, Jean-Michel and Calypso companions study efforts of provincial officials to assist another voyager in his annual migration. Here each summer, nearly a million eels reach the dam after the 3,000-mile journey from the Sargasso Sea.
Even larger eels here, because the mesh is larger here to separate them, down to the smallest eels over there. Could be anywhere from approximately 3 to 7 years old, depending upon the growth rate of the specific eel that's in there. Every single eel is slightly different growth rate, much like people, I suppose. And those are the largest, and there's the smallest ones there.
Some of them are going down. I mean, they must be very tired.
That's right. Here's a couple.
They probably get very tired and they give up. And then they try again. They get stuck somewhere and they try again. Amazing. It's puzzling when you realize that these animals have gone many years to come to that little artificial opening all the way up into a lake. And then they're going to spend a few years.
Netted and weighed to estimate their number, the eels are then released to make their way up the 520-foot ladder to continue their journey to Lake Ontario. Only much later, after 8 or 10 years in the lake, will the eels pass this way again on their return journey to spawn and die in the Sargasso Sea. Sometimes, as Calypso nears Lake Ontario, smallest and easternmost of the Great Lakes, she seems to pass through a toy landscape on which children play. Here, man has altered and rearranged the countryside to his needs. With equal audacity, he builds roadways across the rivers, sails ships above the streets, follows paths of his own making. Above Lake Ontario, the birds pursue older pathways. Flying northward with the season, they follow the compass headings inherited in the genes. But for Great Lakes pilot Morgan Howell, aboard Calypso as it nears Toronto, such skills are not inherited. Threading a course through the seaway's often intricate channels, his knowledge has been won in 100 tense encounters with wave and weather. Like some latter-day Odysseus of the lakes, he is full of tales of high adventure, and all of them are true.
Well, when it comes to my heartthrob and specialty that I love so much, women first. Second is maneuvering a ship in close quarters. I love it. Close quarters. I was brought up that way. I was brought up in the St. Lawrence, running the rapids, Montreal Harbor, Toronto, the canals, and so forth.
Now as a pilot there.
Oh, yes. And they gave me the license. But that wasn't as close water as we have up north. Mm-hmm. Bigger ships, yes.
Do you recall your worst day on the lakes?
Oh, I've had so many of them. That's difficult.
Is there one which is really the bad one? In your memory?
Yes, we were sinking. And only God above saved us. We were sinking on Lake Michigan. Ice, 14 inches of ice. Second day of April, 1928.
That was your worst day ever on the lakes.
Well, we were sinking.
Did you sink?
No, just God above saved us, nothing else.
Saved you? How did God save you?
Of course. If you don't believe in him, you just stay at sea a while. You soon believe in him. Nothing more.
But you got the ship out of there.
Well, the only thing that got her out was a change of wind. Change of wind and the ship swung around back to the south and the ice started melting. All our stays, you see this stay here?
Yes.
They were like stovepipes. Mm-hmm. Our bridge was completely iced over, everything.
At the western end of Lake Ontario, the dawn comes quietly. But sometimes the calm can be deceptive. Dr. Daniel Nelson tells of a summer night when a small American fleet prepared for morning battle with the British ships during the War of 1812.
The British fleet was somewhere off the Niagara River. And during the middle of the night, a very violent storm came across the lake. It hit the Hamilton and the Scourge. It set both ships on their beam's end, and they sank very, very quickly.
So they sank, and this was enough to change the balance of forces?
I think that the loss of these two ships, coupled with the loss of two other American armed schooners 2 days later, the Julia and the Growler, would tend to, at that time, balance the force of the two fleets. Mm-hmm. I believe before the ship sank that the Americans were probably somewhat stronger than the British fleet at that time. This is particularly important because Lake Ontario, throughout the war, was a pivotal strategic place.
Sure.
And whoever controlled Lake Ontario controlled all the land to the west.
Now, you have here a remarkable photograph taken by a side scan sonar. You can see the shadow of the wreck, and you have this, you can see the shadow of the masts, and probably the places where the guns are.
Once more, the Sukhup is swung into position as Calypso's Albert Falco and Dr. Nelson prepare to search for the ship lost almost 170 years ago. But in the turbid waters, the search will be long and difficult. At last, low on power, the Sukhup's lights discern a dim shape at a depth of 300 feet.
There's something. It's hard to see in this murk down here.
Yeah,
you see?
Yeah. There it is. That's a spar. Spar?
Yep.
Okay.
Finally certain they have rediscovered the long-lost American man of war, Falco and Nelson circle the craft in growing excitement.
And that's it. That's the foremast.
How wide? 50 centimeters? No, not that much. Hard to say the size. There's a cannon. There's,
look at here. Right here. What do you think that is, eh?
Look at it, you're looking right down the front of the muzzle of it. Okay. It doesn't like us looking at it, Falco. Look at that gun.
Yeah.
That's a big one. That's
one gun.
I think that's a 32 pounder on her.
She's inclined to the port side, so it's got to be the starboard side.
The stern's down to the right. That's a railing. This is the stern. See that? Stern counter.
Smiling at you, are you?
It's a big dead eye.
What,
for the
movie nights?
Oh, yeah.
Movie nights?
No. Back to old power.
Oh, power.
Power. Let's watch. Oh, wow, yeah. Look at the size of that, eh? We're almost at the end of the dive, then, aren't we?
Enough power to get to the stern?
Oh, not enough power.
Not
maybe you see just to the front and look at that. This is going to come back. Woohoo! You see? What is that, a skull?
Then, out of the depths, a sunken apparition, some lost lady of the lake looms before them.
Good, you. You see?
No, I but I got to get a picture of it. But don't put it out. It's got to recycle.
I can call you.
Okay.
You see, it's got you?
Just a moment.
Yeah.
You can see it because it's short, but I don't know.
Beautiful. What? Cuckoo? No?
No.
There. Oh, yeah, yeah. The statue. That's, hey. That's the figurehead. Yeah, that's the figurehead.
Oh, fantastic.
A wonderful day for me. The first time I see.
A wonderful
one. Two.
It's the first time anybody's seen it for 167 years. Nobody's seen that.
167 years. Big 7 years for me.
Keeping vigil during the Sukhoop's long descent, Cousteau has heard only a few terse messages over the radio intercom. Now, as the craft is brought aboard, he eagerly awaits a fuller report on the discoveries below.
Fantastic!
Fantastic, Don.
You won't believe it.
Really? Beautiful?
There's a bowsprit with a beautiful girl figurehead.
Oh.
Absolutely unbelievable. U.S. Falco. Hard to get that guy excited. He just about jumped out of the sub.
Falco explains that for some reason he had an urge to see the bow. Then as they passed under the stem, he saw the statue of the girl. A beauty with little carvings on her cheeks, oak leaves, perhaps. In the darkness under the bow, it was something marvelous and splendid. Day by day, Calypso sails deeper into the American continent. But now, for a little while, she must journey south, not west. Leave Lake Ontario, smallest of the lakes, enter Erie, the most polluted. Like the great freighters and grain ships that come and go in unceasing procession, Calypso too must sail through the Welland Canal, longest and most elaborate of the bypasses on the seaway system. Here, too, she will enter the locks which provide the highest lift, step by step raising huge seagoing vessels 326 feet from Ontario to Lake Erie above. The bypass is made necessary by one of the awesome facts of American geology, Niagara Falls. Across the width of the Great Cataract divided between Canada and the United States, 100,000 cubic feet per second plunge into the gorge below, leading to Lake Ontario. Unseen, another 100,000 cubic feet race through underground tunnels to the turbines and generators of a vast hydroelectric complex, delivering nearly 4 million kilowatts to the two neighboring nations. Long the inspiration of tourists, honeymooners, tightrope walkers, and daredevils taking the plunge in barrels or large rubber balls, the cataract is the dramatic centerpiece of the Great Lakes system. Created less than 10,000 years ago as the receding ice exposed the great escarpment, the accumulated meltwater of the four largest lakes could then fall to the smallest en route to the sea. Yet time often conceals spectacles no less dramatic. Sinking under the immense weight of the glacier that covered half the continent, lifting as the ice melted and receded, Midland America was a landscape in motion. Northward off the Bruce Peninsula in Lake Huron, Cousteau himself reconnoiters a sunken gorge and escarpment remarkably similar to Niagara. now submerged at a depth of 300 feet, he finds what may have been the site of a ghostly cataract, itself drowned in the inland sea left by the retreating ice. Today, the steel escarpments raised by men dominate the landscape. The cities such as Detroit and a score of other manufacturing centers, the growing population of 50 million Canadian and United States citizens gathered around the great inland seas. It is here that Calypso receives one of her greatest welcomes from the thousands arrayed along the waterfront. An intense expression of citizens' concern for the future of the planet they inhabit. Yet Detroit itself is a paradox, a contradiction. Men feel threatened by the very industries which have improved their lives. Around them, the waters of Lake Erie, like most of the other lakes, have become a cesspool of industrial waste. At Slate Island in Lake Superior, the lighthouse stands guard not against the risks of industrial civilization, but against the dangers of wind and fog and rock. Largest, deepest, and most remote of the Great Lakes, Superior remains the least damaged part of an unparalleled natural resource. The lake system's 5,500 cubic miles of fresh water, nearly one-fifth of the world's supply. Here, Calypso enters a world that still belongs more to wilderness than to man. Here, the rocks still hold evidence of the earliest life forms in the Earth's far distant past. In Nipigon Bay, Dr. Rod Kirkham of the Canadian Geological Survey tells Jean-Michel of a history in which man is only a recent intruder.
This area, there's very old rocks here, about 2.6, 2.7 billion years old, Archean rocks.
Yes.
And there's a conglomerate unit here that about 2 billion years ago, there was a sea came into this area, and this conglomeratic unit, there are boulders in it, was probably formed at the time that the sea migrated into this area. And these are very shallow formations, and there were on the basement, the older basement rocks, and on the boulders in the conglomerate, there were these algal colonies that formed. They formed these circular structures, not unlike modern coral colony. Very early in their history, this particular lower formation was replaced by silica. And if you make microscopic slides of this material, what scientists have found, very well-preserved microfossils, bacteria. And you can see the cell structure, very well-preserved.
From a scientific point of view, what is the value of this?
Well, this represents some of the most ancient life that has ever been recognized in rocks. Now, normally, say perhaps 15, 20 years ago, geologists were under the belief that most life started in the late Precambrian and into the Cambrian, where you actually get megascopic fossils, where you get shells. And that would be about 500, 600 million years ago. This is about 2,000 million years.
Submerged now by the meltwaters of retreating ice a mere 10,000 years ago, the fossil habitations of primitive algae and bacteria colonies, oldest known forms of life, still remain, almost half as old as the Earth itself. Thank you. On the cliffs near Agawa, a more recent visitor has left his mark. Here, Indian descendants of the earliest immigrants from Asia painted the figures of animals that shared their world, pictured journeys in early canoes, created mythologies by which they gave coherence and meaning to the earth and sky around them. Archaeologist Thor Conway describes the pictographs to the Calypso team.
These are copies of pictographs of different rock art sites in this area.
And they often show animals or man-like creatures, or sort of abstract paintings.
The one creature here with the horns is at the Agua pictograph site on Lake Superior. The other one, this is also from Agua, the deer or moose.
Most of this art, what little bit we know about it today, deals with the supernatural and with medicine.
Oh yeah. Because we find some look like a monster.
Right, right. That monster, he's called the Great Lynx, and there's many Ojibwe folk tales about creatures like that, but it's imagination.
Yeah. And all of these pictographs?
They can be up to 2,000 years old. We think that the Indians quit painting them when the Europeans first came here, but the art stops then because we find very few paintings of historic subjects. There's one or two paintings of horses or men with guns, but most of them go back far into antiquity.
For the woodland caribou, to live is to escape. Fleeing the wolf and lynx of the mainland, a small band of caribou long ago crossed the frozen lake, found sanctuary in the Slate Islands, and there remained ever after. But as the band's numbers rapidly increased, nature itself quickly imposed limitations. Lower energy consumption, smaller animals, fewer births, periodic die-offs. Today, the threats to caribou survival on the island are hunger and possible future encroachments of man. As yet, man's intentions are innocent, simply to record and study. But during tagging operations, a Calypso diver quickly finds himself in an underwater chase. Broad, flat hooves adapted to snow, the caribou swims with great efficiency, even breaks into a gallop when closely pressed. Beneath the wings of the startled heron stretches an autumnal landscape not radically changed since the glaciers vanished. A wooded plain stretching westward to prairie, north to subarctic tundra. Yet for this vast vacancy, once tenanted by only a handful of scattered Indian tribes, the nations made war because of the riches hidden in the ponds and blocked streams that gleamed in the forest. It is said that God and the beaver opened the interior of the American continent. In truth, it was the early French missionary priests and the coureurs de bois, or fur traders, who in the early 17th century led the way to the Great Lakes and beyond. The priests to bring back souls to God, the fur traders to bring animal pelts, mainly beaver, back to the snobs of Europe. Like the ermine of royalty and judges, furs became a badge of social or professional distinction. Like a latter-day coureur de bois, Jean Michel leads the Calypso team into the backcountry of Michipicoten Island, still dotted with ponds and hundreds of beaver houses with their family colonies. But as the divers make their way upstream, they must drag not birch bark canoes, but zodiacs and outboard motors through the shallows and portages. As the group approaches one of the basins, it finds that here as usual, the hard-working beaver has made remodeling changes. Deepening the pond to permit free movement in unfrozen water beneath the thick winter ice. Despite the team's caution, the sudden slap of a tail alerts the colony to intruders. But this visit is friendly. Quickly, the divers submerge, begin to explore the pond that in summer surrounds the beaver's house with a protective moat. Here, dry under his frozen dome of mud, sticks, and stones, the beaver remains secure from wolves and other predators during the long, dark months of winter. Prudent, stalwart householder, the beaver is not easily intimidated or bullied from the estate over which he and his family have labored year after year. Instead, he begins an elaborate game of hide-and-seek as he tries to frighten or confuse the intruders, lead them away from the sunken entrance of his lodge. At last, he rises to the surface and surveys his adversaries, still undefeated. Thrifty, resourceful, the beaver has survived far better than many other animals less relentlessly trapped or hunted. Quick to make use of abandoned houses or discarded wreckage, he converts them into straw houses and strongholds for himself. But what the beaver gains, man has lost. Victim of his own excessive demands. Possessed of one of the world's great reservoirs of fresh water, a prodigious resource that can create energy, quench thirst, transport commerce, carry away waste, support aquatic life, and provide recreation, man has watched the lakes become progressively barren for his uses. Along Lake Superior's shores lie many a crumbling fishing village, haunted by a human presence that can no longer sustain itself, by voices we can no longer hear.
also have witnessed a great number of abandoned fishing villages all over Lake Superior. And all these sites that are filmed point to the fact that there is a decrease in fishing. Is that true?
Oh, absolutely. Certainly that's the case, yes. As I was saying earlier, South Baymouth was originally founded as a fishing village, as well as a center for supplying fur-bearing animals for the market. But it was a fishing village, and it's changed now to a really, its principal economy is tourist trade. Mm-hmm. And so one can find a large number of villages around the island which were once principally fishing villages, mm-hmm. or primarily sustained by fishing activities, and they certainly are not any longer. Productivity of fishing, the catches have declined for most species, particularly trout, for example, which was an important fish. It has declined to numbers where it's dangerously low.
Against the fragile system, man's own overfishing is a major cause of today's shrunken catch. But there are other insults to nature. Across the sky, a baleful cloud of smoke brings acid rain to kill life in lakes, sometimes thousands of miles away. Today, the great inland water system has become a sewer for a continent, a receptacle for a growing array of toxic chemicals and industrial waste beyond the lake's capacity to absorb. In Superior, one company discharges as much as 67,000 tons in a day. In Erie, the sediment lies 30 to 125 feet thick. But not all the ills derive from the sins of man. Cousteau and Dr. Brian Anderson talk of a much-hated marine invader.
So there is pollution, one. There is overfishing, two. And then there is the fact that some species have been introduced in the lake, either voluntarily or involuntarily. And involuntarily, I'm thinking of famous lamprey.
Lamprey probably started to gain access to the upper Great Lakes after about 1830, but it didn't really make a real expansion in numbers until probably 1930s as well, when it became very, very, very large densities of them.
And it coincides
very closely with the decline of the trout.
Long considered a gourmet delicacy in Europe, the lamprey is an evolutionary relic without jaws. In adult life, a parasitic creature that lives on the blood of fish. With its suction mouth, sharp circular rows of teeth, and rasping tongue, it attaches itself to a lake trout or other host fish and usually remains until the fish has died, within days, sometimes even hours. Ignoring or discounting the impact of prolonged overfishing, many experts tended to place full blame on the lamprey for the alarming decline in Great Lakes fishing. By 1960, in Lakes Huron and Michigan, the trout were wiped out. In Superior, 90% were gone. Then, after testing more than 6,000 chemical lampreycides, the Canadian and United States teams found TFM, a German-made poison which, if used with utmost care, is said to kill lampreys without killing the trout. Seeking to destroy young or newly hatched lamprey larvae before they advance to the adult parasitic stage, control teams apply the poison TFM to scores of tributary spawning streams on either side of the border. As a result, the numbers of lampreys have been reduced. Simultaneously, the trout and other one-time victims are making a recovery. But if this is in part the result of less intensive fishing, officials are often reluctant to say. The lamprey is a far handier villain on whom to lay the blame.
Poisons of any kind remain a troubling defense. Today, the longer a fish lives, the more residual toxic chemicals he stores in his body. Here, Cousteau, with Falco and Soumian, observes a new hybrid trout which scientists have developed, the splake, which grows rapidly and therefore brings a lower quotient of poisons with him to the dinner table. Like trout, lakes too store poisons, become barren, a submerged landscape from some dead planet far in space. It is we who have made it so. Surface above lie older threats. On the bridge with Jean Michel, pilot Morgan Howell knows them well.
I've seen them many times, but I never set foot on these islands. Further east, yes.
Do you have a particular reason to set foot on them? Because we can bring you there if you want.
Oh, you're very kind. If you have some jolie petite valise, okay. That would be excellent. But the French voyagers, they were real men. They were the first explorers of these islands. And they came through all kinds of storms. And they would weather behind these islands with big canoes loaded heavy with millions of dollars worth of furs, the finest of furs, including white ermine. They made a real history up here. And all that's left is a few Cure de Bois.
Cure de Bois?
Curia de Bois. Runners of the woods.
Right.
And they're fading away fast.
So you did stop there in the past?
Oh, yes, many times.
With other ships? Yeah.
Not here, a little east of here. Right. More east. Right. Oh, yes. Many times. Mostly for shelter from bad weather. Mm. Oh, yes, because we get some nasty southeasters in Georgian Bay. Southeast is one of our nasty ones out here, usually poor visibility. Mm-hmm. Northeast is the strongest and our worst gales. And this one we had coming up this time was only moderate. But just wait till November.
First of the storm hit the Great Lakes that autumn, the sky turned to night with a blackness of blood. We tossed and we turned and we feared for our lives as we entered that stormy hell. The singing of steel and the crack of the bulkheads shattered the clouds across Georgia Bay. Toll of the bell on our foundering ship led us straight to a place called hell. Toll the bell. In the storm, our great ship lay breaking. The decks were awash from prow to stern. Whoa, the wind took the cry from the great lakes of anger, close to the place called hell. Below in the deep, where the shipwrecks lay sleeping, their shadows like ink on a cold, silent bed. No chance of return to the safety of harbor, for hell would soon have us dead. Toll the bell, toll the bell. Oh. voices of children, the howl of the rollers, the splintering steel. Oh, I remember the touch of your hand in the darkness as we entered the gates of hell.
On the night of November 10, 1975, battling frenzied seas and winds up to 90 miles an hour, the ore carrier Edmund Fitzgerald, once the largest ship on the lakes, abruptly vanished with 26,000 tons of iron ore pellets and all her crew. Already low in the water with flooding holds, the Fitzgerald dug her prow into a mountainous wave and never recovered. Instead, she plummeted to the bottom of the lake. Now in the chill depths at 530 feet, she lies untroubled by the fury above. Around her, unseen, there is company in the dark. Scattered across the floor of the lakes lie the moldering hulls of other vessels, great and small. Explorer's canoe and fisherman's trawler, grain carrier and cruise ship, the vast silent fleet that never made port. Still, year after year, the endless procession of great ships crosses the lakes, bound for Detroit, Chicago, Windsor, Toledo, Toronto. In their hulls, they bring Mesabi's ore and grain from the prairies to the steel smelters, flour mills, auto plants, and 100 other industries along the way. Yet, as Jean Michel and pilot Morgan Howell turn Calypso back on its outward journey, more than 2,000 miles to the Atlantic, they know that soon approaching winter will close the waves. Soon a white rim will spread outward from the shorelines, joining at last in a massive sheet that will lock the lakes in a prison of ice from mid-December to mid-April. Sometimes ship owner and crew take a chance on another voyage, another load. But the risks are high, challenging a harsh and unforgiving adversary. Out of the north, with the swiftness of a cat, can come immense polar winds that can wreak havoc in minutes, or slowly fasten an iron grip even on Niagara. Still fleeing winter, Calypso at last reaches the St. Lawrence, already ominously clogged with drifting ice. On the bridge, Cousteau and Jean Michel decide on one final exploration with the Soucoupe. The great deep pocket of salt water trapped beneath the freshwater current near the mouth of the Saguenay River. The crew quickly learns that winter is contemptuous of all man's devices and elaborate technologies. Not only is there difficulty starting the helicopter, but much of the other equipment is stubbornly reluctant to function. Yet for the divers about to enter the icy waters, the cold brings minor blessings. To prevent freezing of masks and tubes of the diving gear, it is necessary to lubricate them with cognac.
look.
Now, as Calypso rides anchor in the darkening fjord, the Sukhup, with Falco in command, is swung from the deck and lowered into the icy waters. At last released by the diving team, the saucer sinks beneath the surface ice, begins the descent through the swift flowing currents of the Saguenay. At first, in the murky waters, the saucer seems to drift under a night sky filled with shooting stars. But as it reaches the buried sea of salt water, it enters a realm of almost crystalline clarity, where jellyfish seem to parachute through the depths. Here the Sukhup's lights reveal an often captive life, an Atlantic wolffish, a solitary and sometimes dangerous predator. A big shrimp in stately progression. A basket star whose reptilian branches resemble a medusa. But then, during the continuing descent, there is a sudden problem. Swept by the current, the Sukhup collides with a submerged wall of the fjord. With faulty communications to the surface, uncertain what damage the saucer may have sustained, Falco starts upward. In the wintry gloom at the surface, aware that the Sukhup may be in peril, the divers quickly prepare to give all necessary assistance. Then at last, relieved, they glimpse the Sukhup's lights as it rises toward them. Soon thereafter, the saucer and its occupants are again safely aboard. Welcoming Falco, Cousteau remarks that it seems to have been warmer below than at the surface. That is true, Falco replies, adding that they were also more anxious. Things went badly, he says, very badly. Falco then tells how they were thrown about as the current swept them against the cliff, nearly 300 feet below. Afterward, unsure whether communications had been broken by the accident, he decided to return and check. Cousteau replies that there were some problems with the sonar communications because the ice floes colliding at the surface made a background noise. Nevertheless, the people on Calypso could hear Falco's voice quite clearly. The Sukhup is safe. Now it is Calypso herself that must run for her life. Winter is closing in, and there still are 500 miles between her and the open sea. Already in the Saguenay, great flows of ice are spreading outward hour by hour, forming a gauntlet that soon will become a barricade. Even now, because the ship rides lower in fresh water, Calypso is taking wounds. Sharp as shattered glass, the ice rises on the bow wave, gouges the wooden planking above the copper that sheathes the ship up to the waterline. While the helicopter goes aloft to scout for lanes of open water ahead, Calypso at last comes to a halt. Once more, Cousteau and his companions consider the bleak, graying world that threatens to close around them, hold them in a vice of iron. To escape, they must break out now or wait till spring. Cousteau makes the only possible choice, gives the order to reverse engines. Then, again moving forward, Calypso slowly gains momentum. Along the St. Lawrence itself, winter has come like a blow. Out of the north, it has brought cold that sears the lungs, congeals flesh to metal at the touch, turns the frozen river into a no man's land of jagged ice. It is a cold that stops life, stops ships. But not all. Already along the river, a fleet of icebreakers is hard at work, clearing lanes and channels through the ice, freeing scores of ships trapped by the freeze. Cutting through ice up to 14 inches thick, the sturdy vessels keep the river open for seagoing traffic throughout the winter, from Montreal to the clear saltwater flow beyond the Saguenay. Today, even more powerful ships have been developed, using compressed air blown from the hull to ease passage. The new icebreakers can cut through ice 3 feet thick. While Calypso finds temporary refuge and repairs in the lower St. Lawrence beyond the ice, Jean-Michel and Falco join the Cousteau Overland Unit, the special expedition bus and equipment truck now nearing the end of their long journey from the far shores of Lake Superior. Now approaching the St. Anne River on the road between Montreal and Quebec City, they have come to keep an appointment with a fish. or more precisely, 500 million of the 8-inch tomcod or poulamon, the so-called Christmas fish. So also have 72,000 French-speaking Canadians come to attend the tomcod's annual spawning rite at La Parade. Here, more than 1,000 huts, complete with television antennae, are laid out on the frozen river in orderly rows on streets of ice. Amid the awesome cold, the Cousteau team arrives to find itself in a yearly winter carnival. Here, families and parties of friends rent the huts and shifts, and fishing continues around the clock. Cars, snowmobiles, and skidoos make an endless traffic at all hours of the day or night. While a curious crowd gathers, the Cousteau team research provides a scientific sideshow as Bernard Delamotte and Dominique Soumian prepare to dive into the frigid waters to observe the spawning fish. Yet the divers find little to report. Under the lights, there seem more hooks than fish, not to list the occasional beer bottle or other evidences of holiday enjoyment. The climate is more congenial in the huts. There, in ranks, family members bait their hooks, undismayed by a temporary lag in the fishing. Soon, they know, the small fish will bite again. A catch of 400 or 500 fish in 8 hours is not unusual.
Fred Law.
In the hut, despite the slow catch, spirits are mellow and rising. With an occasional tug at the bottle to ward off the cold and clear the voice, a song or two seems the thing to do. Upstream, barely 4 miles from the St. Lawrence, lies the main destination of the tomcod invasion. Here, during a few short weeks of winter, the fish migrate, spawn, and return to the big river, followed 2 months later by their newly hatched offspring. Watched by Jean-Michel and Falco, government biologists drill through the ice, bring a sudden upwelling of tomcod. They are, says biologist Yves Maillot, but a token of the teeming millions below. waiting to spawn during the period of frenzy. He holds out a clump of porous ice, indicating the splashes of amber color in the snow. It is the stain formed by the eggs of the mating fish.
Hop,
regarde ça.
Hop,
hop, il est parti.
Later, beneath the ice, the Cousteau team's cameras record the odd behavior of the spawning fish. Tapping their heads against the soft undersurface of the ice, the males create great galleries of indented burrows. These, some experts have speculated, may serve as the nests for the 10 to 50,000 transparent eggs each female carries. In the commercial zone near the north bank of the St. Lawrence, the fishing is not for carnival or sport. Here, the fishermen simply lower the great pockets of the hook nets and haul to the surface a seemingly endless living harvest. Dumped in great sledges, the fish are summarily scattered to quickly freeze and die before being shipped to market.
Helpless, the small fish are scattered by the scraping shovels. Far eastward, caught in a winter gale as she crosses St. Lawrence Gulf to the Atlantic, Calypso too seems small and fragile. Her wind gauge is frozen and her radar blinded by ice. She is reliving the oldest voyages of man, of Phoenician and Greek and Norseman, once blown without compass or radar across a world unmapped.
Just wait till November, the old sailors say. It's a terrible time of the year. If you wish to travel across Georgia Bay, you will have reason to fear. There's a danger when water and sky become one, and the fog makes you blind as can be. When the earth starts to tremble, the man wants to run. Oh, the storms of November are all that is fearful to me. Once the voyagers came on a run from the woods with canoes that were loaded with fur. Now the ships are like giants and loaded with goods, but just twigs when the sea starts to stir. For the waters are driven by a wind straight from hell, and a fury takes over the sea. And the waves are like mountains, boy, mark my words well. The storms of November are all that is fearful to me. They say she's a woman, the ship that I serve. She's a queen and a temptress to me. With my mind and my muscle and all of my nerve, I'll not give her up to the demon who lives in the sea. Just wait till November, the old sailors say. It's a terrible time of the year. If you wish to travel across Georgia Bay, you will have reason to fear. For the waters are driven by a wind straight from hell, and a fury takes over the sea. And the waves are like mountains, boy, mark my words well. The storms of November are all that is fearful to me. The storms of November are all that is fearful to me.
Yet in struggle, early man found love. In myth, he revealed his hope. Ojibwe Indians still tell a legend from the age of the melting ice. Floating on the endless sea, with the animals, the god Manitou sent first the beaver, then the otter, to bring up land from the deep, but they could not reach the bottom. Then the little muskrat volunteered, slipped into the sea. Slowly the long night passed, and in the morning they found the muskrat's body on the surface, his paws tightly locked. Three of the paws were empty, but still clenched in the fourth, they found one grain of sand. Out of that single grain of sand, Manitou made the world. It is pleasant to think that Sable Island grew out of the little muskrat's grain of sand. Today it is a narrow 20 miles bit of land, 100 miles off the coast of Nova Scotia, all that remains of a vast 3,000 square mile island that long ago subsided under the rising sea. Often known as a graveyard of ships, sometimes purposely lured there by wreckers who plundered the vessels, the island today is a shrinking dune, pounded and constantly reshaped by the surrounding seas. A small, lonely world of seals and wild horses and abandoned dwellings, which a handful of volunteers is trying to save from despoliation and oblivion. I think that Manitou's little muskrat would have had much in common with Zoe Lucas.
This island is 20 miles long, and the restoration program has to be rather complicated because there are very few people to help. So what are the most urgent matters to do in this restoration program?
Well, the first thing that we would try to do is, in areas such as this, we try to prevent the salt water from washing over here too quickly so that it increases the erosion and prevents vegetation from taking a hold here. The thing that you try to do in an area like this is to, once you have held the sand in place, is to try to put a vegetation cover on top of it so it starts to build. And so if we would try to plant along the lee side of this artificial dune or this fenced dune, try to get some marum grass, some beach grass growing on here, it will start to hold the sand itself. And as it grows, it collects more sand. And it builds its own dune. And that's the best way to build a dune, is with vegetation, if you can possibly do it.
Did you make attempts with vegetation?
Yes, further.
Can you show me where?
Down here.
You are doing this? Huh? How do you do that? Oh, wow.
But 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 rows.
There's about 400.
400 there. But this is a typical thing that the horses see here, but graze on.
Yeah.
So how do you protect them?
I can't. There's nothing I can do about it.
So you're very courageous, very brave to do this, hoping that the horses will understand and will keep away.
They don't. They seem to prefer the transplanted plants, as a matter of fact, for some reason.
They like them better.
Yeah, they do. Yeah.
Well, I'm very, very impressed, but I'm skeptical about the
results. We've had very positive results.
Tell me, do you love that island?
Certainly, yeah. It's home, I suppose.